Hello, and thank you for joining us for ArcelorMittal's webinar with Automotive Manufacturing Solutions. My name is Joanne Perry, and I am the Deputy Editor of Automotive Manufacturing Solutions magazine. Today, I'm joined by Ludovic Dormigny, PHS Product Development Manager at ArcelorMittal's Global R&D Division. In this webinar, Ludovic will explore how the very high mechanical properties of new PHS grades can be integrated into multi-material parts to reduce the need for reinforcements. The presentation will demonstrate how this can lead to significant mass reductions without compromising the vehicle's impressive safety performance. Before we start, I would like to invite all of you to send questions for Ludovic to address in the Q&A session following the presentation. Just type your questions into the box in the lower right-hand side of your screen. Also, if you experience any technical issues during this session, please let us know using the Q&A box and our team will try to fix it. We hope you will find this webinar stimulating and informative. I will now hand over to Ludovic for the presentation.
Welcome, everybody. Good morning, America. Good afternoon, Europe, and good evening in Asia. So I would like to share with you the vision of ArcelorMittal from the hot stamping market today, and share with you the main orientations of the last developments, the running developments of ArcelorMittal, and try to convince you that these products will allow you to reach efficient, lightweight solutions thanks to this product. So please do not hesitate to ask questions in the chat box. We'll try to answer them today if possible, and later if not. I would really enjoy to have a bilateral discussion with you on this topic. First, I would like to consider the automotive market in three strategical fields: the globalization, the performance, and the efficiency. So globalization, the automotive market is becoming more and more global, worldwide. The performance, of course, any new product has the goal to increase the performance in terms of lightweight, allowing to reduce CO2 emissions, increasing the crash performance with stronger, more ductile steel, and increase the corrosion performance. And finally, the third field of the automotive market, the efficiency. We hope being able with new products to help you to optimize the costs, and efficiency, of course, the costs are the first topic discussed. But we are confident with our new product offer, new solution offers, being able to introduce easier solutions, simpler processes, allowing to reach a more efficient lightweight in automotive projects. First, I would like to come back at the origin of the hot stamping. This is not. I would say it's a traditional slide when in any presentation on hot stamping, but I think it's important to come back at the origin in Sweden, so not the hottest country in Europe, but it started in 1977 by Hartek with the development and the patenting of this technology, which led to the introduction of the first hot stamp part in the Saab 9000s. With door beams, which are typical anti-intrusion applications, with the main following motivations compared to the cold stamping alternative solution, bringing more weight saving potential with higher mechanical properties, allowing to reach more complex geometries with a better geometric accuracy and keep the press forces low. So these initial motivations, which remained important motivations for the hot stamping, the introduction of the hot stamping in the automotive industry, allowed since the 80s to develop drastically the hot stamping in the body in white, And since the 80s, we see an exponential growth of the number of parts, hot stamp parts in the body in white, reaching more than 300 million parts in 2015, according to Schuller estimation, and more than 300 hot stamping lines in operation worldwide. So of course, this drastic development of hot stamp applications in the body in white is accompanied by a drastic evolution and growth of the consumption of hot stamping steel, and translated in tons, we clearly can translate this growth in the consumption of hot stamping steel. So first, it started in Europe and North America, which are the first continents where hot stamping and the automotive market developed, reaching more than 400,000 tons in 2011. This growth has been followed by a second explosion coming from the Chinese market, reaching, according to our estimation, more than 3 million tons of consumed hot stamping steel globally. And we expect a continuation of this growth after, in the next years, through robust demand in the major regions, so Europe, North America, and now China, and the continuation of the globalization trend in countries or continents where hot stamping and the automotive industry is not well developed. So Brazil and India. So we do not expect any slowing down of this growth. And you can see that between 2012 and 2017, the consumption in PHS increased of plus 140%. If we focus now on the most important part of this global PHS consumption, I mean the coated product for hot stamping. If we come back to the origin of this type of product, we have to mention Usibor 1500 alumina ALSI coated, which is the first coated steel for hot stamping used in the automotive industry, which has been introduced in 2001 and reached after 10 years more than 400,000 tons worldwide. So these numbers are a clear proof of the success of this development at that time, which can be explained by the following strengths of this product. So first, process advantages. This product has been developed to make possible a direct hot stamping process, which means no cold stamping step in preliminary. The product can be hot stamped completely in one hot stamping step, no intermediate step between the heating and the stamping, and important topic, no requested surface cleaning at the end of the stamping. These process advantages are accompanied by interesting in-use properties like the excellent protection against perforating corrosion, very good weldability, and the absence of decarburization at the surface of the steel. So all these advantages led to this strong increase of the consumption of this first coated steel for hot stamping. So Usibor 1500 is based on a 22 MMD5 metallurgy, allowing to make possible to reach a martensitic microstructure in a very large process window. And this 22 MMD5 is coated with an alusive coating made of 90% of aluminum, and which is alloyed during the austenitization of the blanc. And this alloying allows to reach the satisfying welding properties and painting properties in a large process window. So when we speak about Usibor 1500, we are often speaking about process window because it is one of the most important quality of such products, allowing to get robust and stable properties in a process window, in a good process window. So, yes, why Usibor 1500 has been successful? So the direct process is, I think it is an important contribution to the success of this product. Now we speak a lot about direct process today in the automotive industry. And just to remember you what we hear behind the direct process, it's no cold stamping step at the beginning, no intermediate step between the heating and the hot stamping, and no sandblasting at the end. And this explains, according to us, the big success of this product, which can be evaluated with market value. I will share with you. So if we look at the evolution of the market, we can see that along the years, Usibor 1500 contribution to the lightweight of the body white increased. Among all the advanced high-strength steel solutions used in the body in white, in 2008, 12% were based on the use of Usibor 1500. In 2020, they should reach 36%. So if we consider this evolution in terms of penetration of the body in white in global, it represented 1% in 2008 of the complete body in white, and 10% and should reach 10% in 2020 and more than 15% in 2025. So meaning that in 2025, 15% of the body in white should be made of Usibor 1500. And now if we try to position the penetration of Usibor 1500 not in the global solutions used for lightweighting, but only on the hot stamp solutions used to lighten the body in white, you can see that in 2015, more than 75% of the lightweight solutions, hot stamped lightweight solutions, were made of Usibor 1500. And that this proportion all along the years is growing, reaching in 2021 more than 80%, so almost 90% of the hot stamp solution made of this AS coated Usibor 1500. So this evolution of the lightweight concept used in the body in white clearly highlights the lead of this product compared to alternative hot stamping concepts developed in the last years. Of course, this development of hot stamp solutions, the development of the demand, the explosion of the demand worldwide, must be accompanied by a development of the hot stamping line able to produce the corresponding parts. I think I wanted to share with you this slide showing that the hot stampers understood this growth and followed this growth and developed their capacity to hot stamp parts everywhere in the world and followed the trend of more than 80% of parts in Usibor 1500. So you can see that 80% of the hot stamping lines worldwide, in Europe, in NAFTA, and in China, are dedicated to the hot stamping of the AS coated Usibor, the AS coated PHS. At the exception, Japan is the exception. The exception today, with only 20% of market penetration in terms of hot stamping lines, because there is locally strong use of zinc coated products for hot stamping. So we can say based on this figure that that Usibor 1500, so AS coated PHS steels, are the most global hot stamping solutions today worldwide. Now, if we speak about the steel itself, of course, to be successful, this growth, this increasing demand has to be followed first by growth of the hot stamping lines, second by growth of the steel capacity or the steel production capacity. On this, I would like to share with you the efforts made by ArcelorMittal to follow this goal worldwide with the multiplication of the lines able to produce Usibor and Duxibor, so this first generation of AS-coated hot stamping steel, reaching 10 lines in 2017 able to produce these products corresponding to a growth of plus 110% between 2012 and 2017. So this number should convince you of ArcelorMittal wish to support this growth and to support the success of this first generation of hot stamping steel. What is important to note is that lines are developed worldwide everywhere where the automotive market is growing and requesting this steel, so North America, South America, and China. So maybe the message to the automotive industry, in fact, I think everybody is conscious that the growth, the demand is growing very quickly and is continuing to grow. And I would like to convince you that we are aware of that and that we will do all what we can do to follow this growth and to make sure that Usibor and Duxibor steel will be available in a sufficient quantity everywhere in the world. This first generation of steel, which has been successful until now, can be positioned, if we speak about the products themselves, can be positioned of the diagram strength crush utility, which is used since some years to position our different hot stamping steels. This diagram allows to explain or to illustrate the compromise between strength and ductility, which is reached by the new hot stamping products of ArcelorMittal. So you can see here the Usibor 1500 with a high strength and a limited crush utility, and the two Duxibor 450 and 500, which had been developed to be combined with Usibor 1500 and made possible as a laser rodded blank, and made possible the management of crush scenario and the crush utility on critical anti-intrusion applications. So these solutions are available now and are used widely. And have been successful. So if we come back to the division of the automotive market strategical field, globalization, performance, and efficiency, I would like to try to explain the reason of this success. So first, if we look at the globalization, we try to develop these products globally, to make them globally available through a licensing strategy, for example, TKS and Nippon Steel, through a dominating footprint of the alusi coated products, and through the support of global teams, research and technical support in Europe, in North America, in Japan, and in China to support the introduction and running industrial production locally where the products are used. That's for the globalization. Dealing with the performance, we spoke about the compromise between ductility and strength, and about corrosion. About corrosion, we consider that this AS coating brings an excellent protection against perforating corrosion. Even if it is not at the level of zinc coating for cosmetic surface corrosion. So it remains a force for this product. And concerning the strength and the ductility, 1500 is today a best-in-class level of strength, allowing to reach a best-in-class lightweighting potential. This accompanied by the possibility to combine this steel with ductibor steel as a laser welding blanks in order to manage critical parts in terms of crush utility. In terms of efficiency, the contribution of this first generation of hot stamping steel is is due to this coating allowing the direct hot stamping, which is today the simplest, so the most efficient process to hot stamp coated steel. And we could demonstrate through different SE motion projects that the lightweighting allowed by this first generation of hot stamping steels could be achieved at no additional cost. So efficiency. And finally, I would like to highlight the full the full set of data available, characterizations, which allows to accompany any new project, any new approval, and to make it as efficient as possible. So these different points are, according to us, the main reasons why this first generation of steel has been successful, and based on that, we started the development of the second generation of hot stamping steel some years ago, trying to target the same strategy, promoting the global availability of this product through a global development involving our labs in North America and in Europe, and a further development of these new products as soon as possible on the other countries where they are not developed yet. In terms of performance, the second generation of steel will offer and is offering a new compromise between ductility and strength, which will allow to bring new opportunities of lightweighting. And finally, in terms of corrosion performance, the second generation of coating for hot stamping will stick to the perforating corrosion performance of the alloy coating product, the current product, and try to improve its weakness, I mean the cosmetic corrosion through development of this product. Finally, in terms of efficiency, must say that the new metallurgies have been developed in order to be coated with the AS coating, which is today according to us the coating for hot stamping steel allowing to reach the most efficient hot stamping processing. So we offer these new steels with the AS coating. And of course, these new products will be and are accompanied by a full set of data available, and I mean especially crash cards, reliable crash cards, which should allow you to validate very quickly, very efficiently the performance of these products, and make their introduction of in new vehicles more efficient, more quick. So based on that, I think that the main orientations of these developments. I would like to make one highlight about the crash ductility, because we speak about a compromise between ductility and strength. It is correct. But to be successful, it was there has been a long work on the way to characterize the crash ductility and the way to fix targets for these new developments based on experience on real parts. We could identify which type of deformation in which stress triaxiality the failure generally occurs, and fixed target for our new developments in terms of fracture strain for this stress triaxiality, I mean the plane strain. So this work that has been done on the crash ductility, which has been shared with you with the community in CHS2, is a new way to conceive new hot stamping steels and to fix new targets in terms of crash ductility, reliable targets allowing to develop steels with a good crash ductility. So based on this research, we determined a test allowing to characterize the steel and to calculate, to evaluate the fracture strain and plane strain. So the test used is the bending test. Most of you already identified a good correlation between the bending and the crash ductility. And we use the same test to validate our new metallurgy and to fix targets in terms of crash ductility to this steel using the fracture strain in plane strain. So UDBOR 2000 and UDBOR 1000, which are the two second generation hot stamping metallurgy, which are positioned here on the graph strength ductility, have been developed with a clear target in terms of crash ductility, which has been determined by the simulation in order to make them able to produce the targeted application. So UDBOR 2000 with a fracture strain in plane strain of higher than 0.25 is a product adapted to most of the anti-intrusion applications in the body in white, and UDBOR 1000 with a fracture strain in plane strain higher than 0.6 is a new product able to produce energy absorption paths with a high lightweight potential compared to standard steel used for such applications. These two products are, so the second generation of metallurgy are under industrialization today in 2016 and 2017, and will be available first in Europe and North America, and maybe under development in China, and could be further developed in South America as soon as the market will be there. In terms of commercialization, we started UDBOR 1000 is today industrial in Europe and in North America, and UDBOR 2000 is industrial in Europe and under industrialization in North America. Just to share with you some main figure, typical figure, just to fix a bit where we are with these steels. UDBOR 1000 and UDBOR 2000 are based are reaching, so for UDBOR 1000, 800 MPa of yield strength and 1000 MPa of tensile strength after hot stamping and paint baking. And UDBOR 2000, more than 1400 MPa of yield strength and 1800 MPa of tensile strength after paint baking. You can see the fracture strain expressed in this table, which are calculated based on the bending test. And you can see the reached targets of more than 0.6 for UDBOR 1000 and more than 0.25 for UDBOR 2000 after paint baking. So making UDBOR 2000 a good candidate for anti-intrusion applications of the body white, and UDBOR 1000 a good candidate for energy absorption applications in the body white. In the next slide, I propose to make a short focus on each of these two products, just to share with you some more details on their performance and on the available data to support any potential analysis of these products. So the first point to be shared with you on these two products is the crash activity, the crash performance, the crash behavior. Of course, many crash tests have been performed in lab with different under different configurations with different lab components geometries in order to simulate the different failure modes that can be observed on a vehicle. So you can see that here results with UDBOR 2000 and the comparison between test and simulation, showing that the development and optimization work performed by our researchers allowed to propose now crash cars with failure models, very reliable which makes possible to simulate the crash behavior of visible 2000 parts and with a reliable failure prediction. The same work has been done, of course, with the hot stamping process. So we had to check to verify that Unibor 2000 can be hot stamped in the same way than Unibor 1500. Some trials have been done on lab components, and you will see later on real parts, allowing to validate that Unibor 2000 can be hot stamped on the same line than Unibor 1500, and that the data available for the hot stamping simulation are reliable and will allow you to validate the use of this product for new applications. One topic on which I will come back on the next slide is concerning the risk of hydrogen embrittlement. You can see here that we recommend control of the dew point during the austenitization of the steel, just to make sure that to limit the introduction of hydrogen during the austenitization. So this steel has been developed in order to be as resistant as possible against phenomenon of delayed cracking. We consider that this development has been successful. You can see that even with higher hydrogen content, higher than what can be seen on standard hot stamping lines, when we generate hydrogen cracks, we always have a mix between brittle and ductile fractures, showing the toughness of the steel even in critical conditions. Nevertheless, everybody knows that at this level of strength, tensile strength higher than 1800 MPa, it is better to limit the quantity of hydrogen in the steel. And that's the reason why we consider that with a dew point lower than minus 5 degrees Celsius in the austenitization oven, the hot stamping of this product should be safe and the risk of delayed fracture limited in the body shop. So I take profit of this presentation and to share with you our process recommendations for the use of Unibor 2000 for a successful use. The most important information is that this is a product with the same coating as Unibor 1500, so the same process windows can be used. The only recommendation for the heating is to control the dew point and keep it lower than minus 5 degrees Celsius. What should not be what is becoming a standard in some regions of the world. Dealing with the quenching, we don't recommend water quenching. We don't need water quenching because the properties reached after a standard dye quenching are already very high and should allow to reach sufficient lightweight compared to a Unibor 1500. We do not recommend any mechanical trimming after hot stamping, because of the risk of delayed cracking. And finally, the Unibor 2000 parts must be painted, meaning they have to be paint baked during the e-coating in order to reach their final properties. So meaning that we took into account this part of the automotive, the car maker process, for the reaching of the final properties, meaning the yield strength, the tensile strength, and the crash utility. Dealing with Unibor 1000, in the same way, lots of crash tests have been performed in lab in order first to validate the level of crash utility reached by this development. And such tests in compression allow to validate the ability of these products to be used for energy absorption applications. And in parallel to that, crash models have been developed, failure models. So it was a development and an optimization of realized cars, allowing to make possible a reliable failure prediction every crash situations. And all these crash tests in lab allow to validate that Luxibor 1000's crash utility is higher than the crash utility of Unibor 1500, whatever the crash condition. So it leads us to the applications, which applications are targeted by these products. So this is based, these assumptions are based on S-in-motion projects, on numerical simulations, on body-in-white, allowing to validate the possibility to use these tools on the considered applications. So of course, Unibor 2000 is a very good candidate for anti-intrusion applications, and Luxibor 1000 for energy absorption applications. And they can be combined in the form of laser welding blanks, either between themselves or with the other products of the Unibor and Luxibor family, because they have the same coating, the same laser welding process can be used, and it should create lots of new opportunities of lightweighting concepts. So here are two examples of parts which have been produced in reality, hot stamped by our researchers. First, to validate the hot stamping process, to validate the ability of the weld to be deformed, and to validate, you can see here on the last film, the crash performance of this product, making comparisons between experience and simulation. So based on S-in-motion projects, based on crash simulations, it has been possible to estimate, so first to validate that these products are well adapted to these applications, but to allow us to validate or to estimate the weight saving potential compared to existing solutions. So compared to existing solutions, we expect reaching a 30% weight saving, weight reduction of the body in white through the massive introduction of Unibor 2000 and Luxibor 1000. And if we consider a body in white made of the first generation of hot stamping steel, this weight saving should remain higher than 10%. So these two products, as already said, are second generation of steels, meaning available now. Available now with a complete set of data to support their introduction on new vehicles. Of course, welding, delayed cracking, and crash data have been determined in order to support you, knowing that these are very important properties, in-use properties for new stamping steel. Remaining in the second generation of products, I would like to present one product, one coating. So we do not develop only new substrates, but new coatings too. You know Unibor 1500 AS coated with its strength and its weakness. So the strength is the excellent resistance against perforating corrosion. The weakness is the cosmetic corrosion. So it's only a surface corrosion phenomenon, but which can be annoying for some applications. In order to stick to the forces of the AS coating, we developed a new product called Unibor Protect Plus, based on the same coating, but with an improved surface functionality, which allows to drastically reduce the apparition of red rust in certain conditions. This product is a second generation product, meaning soon available. Unibor Protect Plus industrialization is planned mid of next year, and we are already able to provide any material to customers wanting to evaluate the corrosion performance of this product. Now, if we try to go a bit further and speak about what should be or could be the third generation of hot stamping steel, so substrate or coating, Of course, we try to stick to these three main fields, strategical fields of the automotive market, and try to develop global solutions, performance solutions, and efficient solutions. In terms of globalization, we'll try if possible to make new products available everywhere in the world, compatible with every asset of ArcelorMittal worldwide. In terms of performance, we have clear objectives, targets, first in ductility. We spoke about compromise between strength and ductility. The third generation of steel will mainly focus on ductility because we identify this parameter as a key driver to reach more lightweight in the future. In terms of corrosion, we have to be as close as possible to zinc coatings for cold stamping. It is a reference today on the market, and we would like to be closer as possible to this reference with new coating concepts. Still compatible with direct hot stamping, still allowing large process windows, and not increasing the risk of stress corrosion cracking. Finally, in terms of efficiency, the efficiency of the alu-z coating should be kept as much as possible, as long as possible, with direct process, with robust process, so it will remain a target for any new development. The third generation has then and finally, we efficiency means for us try to find solutions to reduce cost and increase the productivity of hot stamping solutions. And this part of the this demand of the market is taken into account in our development and will be part of our third generation of hot stamping steel. So we don't know what the cars will look like in the future, but we know or we hope that they will be made of UZ board and UT board. Thank you for your attention. I hope that you can ask your question.
Okay, thank you, Ludovic. The questions have been flooding in, so we will now begin the Q&A session. And the first question is, do you foresee any weldability issues with the UZibor 2000 grade? If so, how could they be avoided?
So welding results are available. Of course, the product is weldable in terms of welding ranges. You can weld it. The most critical point is the resistance, mechanical resistance of the spots, which are not better than UZibor 1500 spots. If you were at the SCT conference, you may have the opportunity to take profit of the presentation of my colleagues. I would say for critical combinations, we have process solutions, welding process solutions to increase the mechanical strength of the spots. But we could demonstrate that in realistic combinations, heterogeneous combinations are generally not critical. But in case of homogeneous combinations, which could be critical in terms of cross tensile strength, we have solutions to adapt the welding process and to compensate this loss of mechanical strength. But for any, we are open to discuss this point with any customer because welding results are available and the experience has been gathered in the last year, allowing us to provide an efficient support for that.
Okay, the next question is, have you investigated and found a solution for UZibor contamination on furnace rollers?
Um, Yes, indeed, developing new products with the same coating will not solve this risk. Of course, AS coatings are sensitive to pollution of waters in the furnace. Nevertheless, we stick to this coating today. We hope that new coatings may be less sensitive to pollution. We have to check that. But we don't have any miracle products to avoid that completely. But I agree. In some cases, this pollution is difficult to avoid, and so we are available to discuss any critical cases and to provide recommendations to limit this risk as much as possible. But we know the main drivers of this pollution, and we can provide technical support to limit this risk and contain it.
Okay, can you now comment on what was done to improve the cosmetic corrosion?
So you mean yes, the cosmetic corrosion. So it's we speak about Uzibor Protect Plus. So maybe you heard about AS Improved in the past. Okay, the Uzibor Protect Plus is the brand name of this new product, which will come on the market next year. This product is based on the same coating as the original Uzibor 1500. With the improvement of the phosphatability of the surface of the coating, making possible to improve the paint adhesion on this product and allowing to reduce the risk of red rust pitting after e-coating. So it is a modification of the surface of the steel, allowing to make the surface phosphatable.
Okay, the next question is it possible to make a soft zone on Uzibor 2000?
Maybe. We are not hot stampers, and we are not hot stampers making partial hardening or soft zone, playing soft zone to hot stamp steel. So it's difficult for us to answer to this question, but of course I think that this technology may be a good technology for such a steel, but we have to see, we have to test it, and maybe yes, I think it's more in the case of hot stampers to evaluate that, but we are open to check that as soon as we can have some process conditions to test in lab, but today I have no answer to this question.
Okay, the next question is, can you expand on why water quenching is not recommended for Uzibor 2000? What would be the results if water quenching was used?
So this recommendation is based on the past experience with Uzibor 1500, which showed that quenching too quickly increased the risk of delayed fracture. So not due to the introduction of hydrogen, but due to the fact that we reach a very a brittle Martensite site through the quick quenching and reaching a. And the higher the properties, the higher the risk. If you look at the properties of Uzibor 2000 after die quenching, you can see that we reach a very high level of tensile strength, which is according to us sufficient to save more than 10% the light to save weight of until 10% compared to Uzibor 1500. So we consider that does not make that it is sufficient, and it is not worth to increase the risk of delayed fracture just to gain some more hundreds of MPa on this product. So it is more a question of compromise between lightweight potential and risk. And with under die quenching conditions, we consider that this product can be safe if it stands in proper conditions. Using water quenching may increase a bit too much the risk of hydrogen embrittlement.
Okay, next question. For cutting or trimming, is there an alternative technology to laser cutting for usibore and ductibore?
First, for ductibore, there is no reason not to recommend the hard trimming or the mechanical cutting. So ductibore 1000s, ductibore 500 are steel which are not sensitive to the risk of hydrogen embrittlement, and they can, according to us, be mechanically cut. So the only product for which we recommend not to use any mechanical trimming is ductibore 2000 because of the level of strength of this steel and because of the higher risk of hydrogen embrittlement. So this recommendation is only concerning ductibore 2000. Concerning the alternative technologies which could be considered, we think currently at the hot cutting, which is a technology which is under development, I would say, which is not well spread today on the market, but which could allow to reach the same level of safety in terms of hydrogen embrittlement at a limited cost. But it's still a development, and we are not able to provide very precise hot cutting conditions to support any new project with this product. Nevertheless, I would say it's a technology which should be successful, and yes, we try to open the ears, and some developments, some research projects are running on alternative cutting technologies, and of course we would like to look at them, but today I have no alternative to be proposed to laser cutting, which would be completely validated by us. So today, laser cutting is a technology which is already used a lot, and we'd recommend to continue using it for ductibore 2000s to not to add, to multiply the risk.
Next question. What furnace temperature do you recommend for the ductibore 2000 and 1000 grades?
What I can say is that we don't have a clear recommendation. We can provide the transformation points of the CT diagram. Nevertheless, we think that ductibore 2000 is a very flexible product, not requesting as defined rules in the thermal cycle during the hot stamping. We think that the 100% martensitic microstructure will be reached in lots of conditions, under lots of conditions. The only open question is that we have to check it, to check the impact of different extraction temperatures on the mechanical properties. And we are working on that to make possible recommendations in the near future.
Okay.
But, maybe if I may, just a general comment on ductibore 2000 hot stamping. So I confirm that ductibore 2000 can be hot stamped in the same conditions as ductibore 1500, but the experience we made by in the research showed that it will be easier. It is easier to hot stamp QZ Bor 2000 than it is to hot stamp QZ Bor 1500, meaning that one given hot stamping process used for QZ Bor 1500 should allow to hot stamp QZ Bor 2000 in a good way.
Okay, next question. I'll just ask one or two more because there are so many. I think we will have to forward them to you later. Next question is there any approval from VW for these new materials? Is there any approval from VW for these new materials?
I do not understand the question, sorry.
Is there any approval from VW for these new materials?
VW?
Yeah. Volkswagen.
I'm sorry, I cannot answer to this question now. I'm a bit surprised by the question. Sorry, I cannot answer.
Okay. I'll move on to the next one. How much will the tonnage requirement increase when forming next-gen QZ Bor 2000 as compared to QZ Bor 1500?
Sorry, I cannot answer, but I would propose to come back to the people who asked the question to maybe to discuss this deeper, but I don't know. I cannot answer to this question now. Sorry for that.
Okay. We will actually draw the Q&A session to a close at this point. And we will forward the questions on to you, Ludovic, later, so that any we didn't answer here will be answered by email. Thank you to Ludovic for a very informative webinar. As always, the webinar will be uploaded into the AMS archives and accessible in future for all of your colleagues who have been unable to join us for the live presentation. You can access this and all of our previous webinars via the webinar tab on the Automotive Manufacturing Solutions homepage. Finally, we would like to get your feedback on this webinar, and so there is a short survey coming up. Please take the time to complete it, as we would very much appreciate your input. Thanks again for taking part with us today, and I hope you will join us again for our next webinar.